First of all, warm welcome here in Vienna on behalf of the local team here. I hope you are having a good time. So, about my dog. Last year I had to take many exams on university. So I did what any other good student would do, and I looked for some distraction, any distraction at all. And that was when I decided I want to build something. And what I did make was a smart mirror, something like this here. The hardware was pretty straightforward. I included the touch screen for some reason. If you're doing the same, don't include a touch screen. That's no use of a mirror. Yeah, but it has an x86 board, some pretty straightforward hardware. But the interesting part, the thing I want to focus on this talk here, is the software. I wanted to have a nice, good-looking, simple user interface, and therefore Qt framework and QML was the obvious choice here. Anyone disagreeing here? Not in this conference, I guess. Good. Yeah, so I wanted to have an user interface written with QML, but I didn't want this whole big C++ project. I wanted something simple, something that could work as a prototype. And that's when I stumbled upon a blog from Qt that you don't always need those Star Destroyer powers of C++ that blasts your biggest problems away, but could also turn out to be the one problem you have, that you sometimes want something easily navigatable, something simple, like the Millennium Falcon here, Python, in this analogy. So that's what I decided to use. Qt with Python. So I could have all my Q objects with signals, logs, and models in Python code, but still have all the powers from QML as user interface and specification on the other side. So how does this actually work? Historically, there were two projects. The first one is PyQt from a third-party developer from Riverbank Computing, which provided Python bindings for Qt, which were licensed under GPL. And there's also another project initiated by the Qt company back then when it was still owned by Nokia that also provided Python bindings. They did it because they wanted to use LGPL as license. GPL was too restricted. So another project was born using another binding generator named PySage, which a few months ago got renamed to Python for Qt and is now the officially high priority project from Qt, which will bring a complete Python solution to Qt, coming with an integration in the Qt creator. But it's still not ready yet. The first technical preview got released in June. And the aim is to provide a complete integration with the next major release of Qt with version 5.12, which should come, I think, at the end of November, beginning of December, if I'm right. Correct me if I'm wrong, please. But yeah, so what is all this binding stuff here? Basically, it allows you to use QML in your Python world to have access to all classes provided by the Qt framework. And I think the best demonstration for this is to just show an example of this. You may already be familiar with the Wiener Linien, the public transportation service here in Vienna. And I wanted to see the departure times of my bus leaving in front of Metoir on right when I walk back out. So here's what you would do in a C++ world. You'd define your plugin, and that's the basic boilerplate stuff for a QML plugin. And it feels exactly the same in a Python world. It's just much more denser code, much more simple, no boilerplate stuff. But you use the same methods, you don't have to learn anything new, you just reuse your C++ knowledge. You can define your own objects with signals, and it doesn't care if you use any classes provided by Qt, like the Qt abstract list models, or if you use native Python types like lists or strings. You can define your model items like you would in your C++ code. But the big plus point is that you get all those nice features Python provides out of the box for you. For example, those new async I/O methods, which were introduced in Python 3.4. You can write coroutines and concurrent code without blocking the whole user interface. So you can make calls to a web service, and it's in a small code, or it's easily readable, and it just feels good to write this code. And it, again, behaves like you would expect. You have a QML plugin that you can use afterwards in your QML project. There are applications available to generate a module description, so you can use it afterwards in Qt Creator, and you get all those autocomplete stuff like you usually would. You can import this module you've written and just use it. I also integrated some smart home logic in this project. A home assistant is a smart home framework I can recommend. And I also integrated this in QML. Here you can see that you can define slots with the PyQt slot decorator in Python. And afterwards, you can use the slots here in QML again. Here's it, the start slot, for example. So let's skip this. And now we have those Python code and QML code, and we want to combine these two. I think you're already familiar with QML. You can import Python models here and just use them. And you can write your main file in Python, which just sets up the application. The specialty here is that you can integrate dbus, and that you can integrate async I/O main loop with the Qt main loop. This works using the QA mesh project. So async I/O needs some kind of event loop running, and the thing about Qt is that you already have the Qt main loop. So QA mesh can combine those two requirements and get those things together. And yeah, that's how the whole project is set up. In the future, I was thinking about maybe enabling Plasma for it, write some Plasma for it. I didn't have time for it yet, but the next exams are coming up, so I will have some more distraction then. So yeah, thank you.